We are so glad you're here. Feel free to grab your coffee. Come on into worship. We're going to spend a little bit of time together worshiping and just praising God together, praising God for this beautiful weather that we've been having. It's like pre-fall, right? I'm going to invite you to all stand as you are able. And we're going to read a psalm together as we start worship. And also just want to invite you, this is a safe place where we can just sing and worship and give thanks. So if you feel like closing your eyes, if you feel like raising your hands, if you feel like sitting down, I hope you'll sing. But even if you feel like you just need to pray a little bit while we're playing, I invite you to do that because it's all worship. And we're so happy that you're here with us. Dennis, can we get that psalm on the screen? Let's all read this together as we enter into a time of worship together. Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord who minister by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who is the maker of heaven and earth. Let's all worship the Lord together.
Great things. Come on.
Oh, hero
free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great. You do great things. Oh, you are worthy of all praise. You are. Oh, oh. Yes, we welcome you this morning. Oh, you are worthy. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. That one more time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God.
Above it all.
Hallelujah, God.
Unshakable.
Hallelujah, you
have done great things. Yes, you have. Oh, you do great things, God.
Sing this together.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, the name above every other.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Worthy.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you.
You are holy.
As you are holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's sing worthy of every song. This is our prayer, Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
You alone are.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, it's your name.
Jesus, the name above every other name.
Only you, Jesus.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Yes, you're worthy.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. 'Cause you are holy. holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love.
Holy, there is no one like you.
And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
I will build my life,
and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. And I will,
holy, there is no one,
and holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your
love to the
holy God. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
I will
build my life upon your love. It is a
firm foundation.
I will put my trust in you alone. And I will my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Space in which we know God is committed to filling is always the present. So much of our life is characterized by sort of either a shame or a regret or a nostalgia of the past or some sort of anxiety or desire for the future. And it's not that the past and the future are a problem. It's that the presence of God is committed to the present moment at every second of the day. And what that means is that God is constantly unfolding in our midst, whether we feel it, sense it or not. The unfolding of God is what we can count on most in this life, like oxygen. The invisible presence of God permeates all the universe. It's beautiful. It's free for everybody. It's grace, and it's good. And so I think as we move toward just a moment of just stillness and prayer, where do you need breakthrough right now? It would be a shame for us to come into this place and worry about the past or have anxiety about the future and not say, God, in the present, instead of just stuffing this stuff in me, I want to voice it that this is where I am, and this is where I need your presence in my present moment. And so would you just get clear about that? Where do you need breakthrough? Where do you need more life, reconciliation? Where do you need freedom?
a release of the presence of God. And so, Holy Spirit, right now, would you just fill our imaginations and our hearts with specific ways that you're calling us to call on you? Forgive us of calling on ourselves or making demands of others that they're not capable of fulfilling, that only you are. So, God, we present ourselves before you, and we give this to you. We articulate this in our hearts because we need you. So, God, will we just give us words to articulate where we need breakthrough right now of more of your presence? One of the significant challenges, I think, for more breakthrough in my life is that it's full. So what does it mean to make room, make space for more of creativity toward the kingdom of God and a deeper longing for God's presence? And so that's one of the reasons we pray this prayer. Prayer of confession says, I want to create space for the presence of God, and I've got this clutter, I've got this stuff, I've got this brokenness, I've got stuff in my life. Some of it's not all bad, but I just want to clear space for the fullness of God to meet me where I am. And so we pray with people all over the world saying, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, in word, and in deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. Through your Son, Jesus, have mercy on us and forgive us. And the prayer usually continues, we'll put on there next week, that we may delight in his will and walk in his way to the glory of his name. Amen. Friends, the peace of God is here. We don't have to invent it, make it up, or do anything to perform for it. God says, I give you my peace. And so with that, we can extend that peace to one another. So may the peace of the Lord be always with you. Greet one another, and we'll call you back in just a moment. Good to see you. If you are a guest, I see so many familiar faces, which is beautiful every Sunday. If you're a guest, we just want to say welcome. My name's AJ, one of the pastors here, and Turner is our resident Deion Sanders / Bo Jackson, so he just sort of does it all. So I'm gonna take this segment of community life for us today. But my name's AJ. It's a joy to be together today. This weather, anyone? Hello. Yes. More of this. This is wonderful. Thank you. Yes. Claps for the weather. We're grateful for that. Hey, let me start you off with Sunday Plus. A few things you need to know for next week. Let's say this together, 10 a.m. Are you ready? We got to get more participation than that. Are you ready? 10 a.m. is our one service next week. We want to bring both communities together. Why? Because we want to have lunch together afterwards. What it means to be the church is to be a people, not a program. And so we want to come together. And if you want to stay afterwards, we'll have a lunch here. And we just want to hang out. So we'll be at 10 a.m. The second service will join us. And we'll just have a beautiful time together of worship and just seeing faces that maybe you don't get to see normally who go to one of the other services. And so such a joy to do that. And so 10 a.m., hope you'll join us there. What is next on the docket? If you have not joined a small group, by the way, can I just say, like, thanks to all of those that lead these things. It's amazing. and it's effortful, and we're grateful because we want to be a people and we want to be on journey together. And we have some spatial challenges here that we're constantly wading into of just meeting space. And so if you meet in a home or you meet in one of our facilities, we're just grateful and we want to see that continue to go as we grow as a people. So join in one of these things. You can find information in the back corner. We'd love to have you connect in that. What is coming up at the end of October, just to save the date, more information. I'm going to go into this deeply next week, but there is a full day on a Saturday where we want to come together. We want to eat. We're flying in a friend of mine who is an amazing communicator about the person and nature and work of the Holy Spirit. And we really feel like as a church, we want to focus in on the third member of the Trinity in this fall and to really go deep into what it means to be people of the Holy Spirit. And so it won't be weird, but it will be creative and imaginative about what God has for us through the life of the Spirit in our church and us as individuals and together. So I'll tell you more about that next week, but save the date. That's the last Saturday in October. There's a men's hang coming up, Fire and Iron. Come and hang out. There's no agenda. It's just a great time to gather around and get to know some other blokes in the area here, and we're going to be having a fire on the other side of our campus. There's a barn there. We'd love to have you. And also a women's gathering. That's a little bit later. That's October 21st. That's coming up. Bring an appetizer to share, and that's going to be an amazing connect event for women, and we'll tell you more about that as the date approaches. And last, I want to read to you something from our partners in Haiti. And actually, Capers, can you just bring my phone here? I want to let you know, we don't talk about this as enough as we should. When you give here, 3% goes, thanks, brother, 3% goes to our ministry partners in Haiti, 3% goes to ministry partners in Honduras. Another, let's see, these breakdowns are always tricky for me to remember. I think another 5% goes to church planting and in our diocese, and another 4% goes to local mission here. And so we haven't talked about Haiti in a bit, and for reasons because we haven't been able to get down there. Well, TJ Johnston and Nancy Haygood were able to go last week into a really dangerous environment, and we support a clinic there that does a ton of medical procedures and just caring for a lot of children and a lot of people in Haiti. And I just want to read you an update that Nancy left us after her trip. She wrote to us this week, "As you know, the last few years have been challenging in Haiti, first with COVID and then with national instability. And since April, our partners in Haiti have been unable to travel to or work from the clinic due to gang violence. However, our partners quickly adapted to the situation and remained committed to serving their brothers and sisters in need. They pivoted to a different neighborhood nearby that remains safe. They rented a church building and have been running a fully operational medical and nutritional clinic there. The resilience, perseverance, leadership, and commitment to service of the team in Haiti cannot be overstated. Even with this new clinic set up, our partners in Haiti face tremendous risks every day, traveling to and from work, school, church, market, etc. In a country that most people, this is so beautiful, in a country that most people are fleeing, our partners there remain steadfast in their commitment to serving. They are weary, and they're in need of encouragement and support." We just want to say, as extended partners all the way from the U.S., where we don't fear going to the marketplace right now, we want to connect hearts with them. We want to be empathic and be people that say that's the body of Christ doing the work of Jesus in the nation of Haiti, which also is under threat of Fiona coming through as a storm right now. And so can we just pray for the nation of Haiti and just extend our hearts in every way? So pray with me as we just extend our longings for you, God, to renew and to restore and to set up infrastructure in every way in this country where there can be a future. Thank you in the present that you're available through our ministry team. We pray for Light from Light, and we pray that your Spirit would lead them to continue to serve. We thank you for ways that we can be generous in our resources, just seeing this clinic stocked with all the materials they need to help be healing agents in this part of the world. So we ask for renewal, and we connect our hearts with them as they grieve and as they seek to stay and to be healers in Haiti. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a beautiful thing, and it's a hard thing, and I'm really grateful for your generosity and your partnership in every ways that you give, including financial, and so thank you. That being said, let's clear our hearts a little bit more for the hearing of the teaching text this morning. If our reader could come forward, let's hear the word of the Lord.
Our reading is from Nehemiah, beginning at the 17th chapter. But they, our ancestors, became arrogant and stiff-necked, and they did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them. Our second reading is from Matthew's Gospel, beginning at the 16th chapter. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for that was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." The word of the Lord.
God. Well, we are an Anglican church, and what that means, I think, is that we're committed to at least three things. And you can count on these three things being present in our church body. We are committed to the Spirit, we are committed to the sacrament, and we are committed to the Scripture. We are guided by that framework. And when I say we're committed to the Spirit or to the Scripture, you might be like, why do we read these Scriptures that sometimes have something to do with the sermon and sometimes some of the Scriptures don't? Well, what we want to do is to make sure every single week that we are in the whole counsel of God. So you'll typically, almost always, hear a reading from the Old Testament. Notice we begin with a psalm, typically. And then you'll also hear a reading from the New Testament or the Gospel as well. And so what we want to do is to say, even if some of these Scriptures, if you're like, why do we do that every week? What's that about? It's about making sure that the Spirit can speak through the Word in the whole counsel of God. Why? Because through the whole Bible, and this isn't obvious, not every Christian has this framework, through the whole Bible, Old Testament all the way through Revelation, Genesis to Revelation, God is telling one unified story. And it's one God in three persons. It's not that the God of the Old Testament is against the God of the New and they're warring or something. It's that God is telling one story. And so to hear chapters of that story throughout the history of civilization is really good for us to make sure that we understand the whole counsel of God. Does that make sense? So it's one of the reasons you hear those scriptures every single week from different places. Now, we've been in a conversation called the Apostles' Creed, and if you come from Baptist background such as I did, don't freak out. It doesn't mean that we're sort of leaving the Scripture, that we think that the entire narrative of Scripture is contained in these 18 lines, that these 18 lines that we have in the Apostles' Creed help us to narrate and unfold the entire Scripture. And I don't know if my remote is working. Oh, which went back? Let me see here. It gave me more power with this thing, and I don't know what to do with it. Hello, Turner. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. We're going to read this text again. Here we go. Yay. This is what's called the Apostles' Creed. And these are the lines, 18 lines that basically unfold the entire story the Scripture is telling. Now, I think it's interesting. I went to the USC game, not U of SC. I went to the USC game yesterday, and South Carolina was playing Georgia, and I got there early, and it was, you know, the 2001 thing they hold. It was amazing, and like it was to see so many people rallied around story and longing and passion and heart. It's such a great analogy to what it means to think about the creed, that all of us in one frame or another, whether it's with sports or whatever it is, we long to be part of a story that matters, a story that's unfolding. And one of the things that I noticed that a lot of sport traditions, it's really important for them to tell us their history. Well, back in 1943, or we're the winningest program XYZ, or what happened in 64, all of these things come up. Why? Because the story, the long story that's being told matters, and that it moves into the present to say, we're still part of that story, and we're still part of a Gamecock tradition, or whatever that is, right? And it's the same with the creed, that we are part of this long story that God has been unfolding. And what I would say to that is that living into this story, what we would believe and what Christians have professed for thousands of years, living into this story is what makes a human being supremely joyful. This is the story. If you're looking for joy, if you're looking for rooting, if you're looking for a future, this is the one that has been secured. In the Greeks, they called this quest for happiness, they called it eudaimonia. If you came from a Greek perspective, you would say the meaning of life, and we see this even today, we are all living to maximize happiness. The decisions that we make in this life are in hopes of becoming happy, hopes of becoming fulfilled. That has been part of the human quest since the beginning of time. And what this creed wants to tell us and orient our hearts is to say that your happiness, your supreme joy, is not actually discovered in materialism or workaholism or any other ism on earth. When you have a better story, it roots you in a moment to where you can stand firm no matter what life circumstances change. And here's the thing, they will. You can count on change in your life. And I think what the framers of this in the early church were saying is if you can live here, if you can keep this as your guiding story, you can endure any political moment and not lose your cool. You can endure any financial situation and not lose your heart. You can endure any family or job conflict and not lose your peace. You can endure any football season and still keep your joy. That this is the story above every story. And we don't just know it here. We believe it here. You can know something and do nothing about it. But when you believe something, it moves you to take steps, to walk in a kind of direction. It moves the heart. It stirs the soul. And so it begins, I believe. Why? Because God wants your minds and your hearts and your wills, all of your being moving in this world amidst all of life's circumstances, whether they change or stay the same. We are rooted in a story that moves us from one moment to the next. And so let's begin by saying the entire story of God in just 18 lines. And if you will you indulge me if you're willing and able and stand? Let's get some blood flow. You don't have to say this. This is a pledge of allegiance to the kingdom of God. If this isn't your story, no one's looking. You can just absorb it and take it in. If you want to say it with me, it goes like this. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would just help us to know what this means for today. Not to just say something rooted in the past or something for some sort of future, but for the present. What does this mean for my Monday morning? And I ask this in your name. Amen. You may be seated. So printed in the back, if you missed last week, we had a bunch of sheets printed in the back. If you were looking for that and you missed last week, you're like, oh, we ran out. You can grab one of those in the back on that table. If you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry about it. But let me put some color into this. So when we think about the creed, I want to show you something that the writers intended for us to notice, but we often don't, and we certainly haven't been taught it often in our lives either. I want you to notice there's a kind of structure to this. That structure is built on the three persons of God, the three God in one, that the creed is telling a triune story that has Father, that has Son, that has Spirit. It is triune. And today we look at the second part of the creed, the person of Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, the second member of the Godhead. And let me just say, this has been contested in centuries. This is not obvious, the creed, the second part. And so we want to walk through at least this first line of the second part. I love what Ben Myers has to say. He says, many tend to think of creeds as cold summaries of doctrine, but the real centerpiece of the Apostles' Creed is not a doctrine. It's a name. Our faith centers on personal attachment to Jesus. You'll notice that's why the majority of the content of the creed is ensuring that as the Christian faith is spread into all the Roman Empire and later all of the world by which we were a part of, all the way on the other side of the planet, wants to make sure that we understand the significance of Jesus. Look, this, I think, is so helpful that our faith hinges on a name. And here's one of the reasons why, and this is personal, so you can take this or leave it. But one of the things I've noticed in recent years as I have colleagues all over the country pastoring, planting churches, I have noticed that more and more communities of faith are becoming centered on social issues. They're becoming centered on social issues, and they have sort of, in many ways, lost the center of the proclamation that Jesus is the victor and king of the universe. It's almost like we use Jesus to talk about that thing that we really want to talk about over here. And so let me use Jesus not as the subject of the universe, but an object that I can use to advance my cause. And I'm not saying that there's not a place for social issues, because there are. We just talked about healthcare in Haiti. It matters. It's huge. But when it's the headlines of the day that begin to dominate the liturgy of the church, when Jesus is used as a prop to promote social issues, I think the church loses its power. When all we do is want to use Jesus to do our thing over there. I'm all about that thing over there, but not at the expense of using Jesus or forgetting him altogether. And I think the church that stays rooted in the Son being the center of what we care about most, that Jesus is the center of who we are, I think that's where you see power released and you see a people that are joyfully serving the world. St. Peter's is and will always be our mission statement, a community following Jesus for the sake of the low country and beyond. The reason we have following Jesus in the center is that we don't just want to be a community for the sake of the low country and beyond. We want to be a Jesus people who are rooted in him. They can't shut up talking about just how great he is. And that's what moves us into the world, because that's what he did. He moved into the world. He moved into the neighborhood and spread love and joy and justice. The name of Jesus, it's his life within us that brings us together. And it's his fame that we seek to spread everywhere we go. So I love Ben's wisdom here, because the real centerpiece of the Apostles' Creed is not doctrine, or I would add in our time, I think it would be, is not an issue, but it's a name. It's a name. Okay, let's play a game. We'll call it, Who's That? So let's think about this through the framework of Who's That? I'm going to read you a proclamation. It's an ancient proclamation that was going around a couple thousand years ago, and I want you to guess, Who's That? It goes something like this. Since providence, or that life force that's underneath everything, that holds all things together, since providence, which has ordered all things and is deeply interested in our life, has set in most perfect order by giving us whom? Who's that? By giving us what person? Who was filled with virtue that he might benefit humankind, sending a savior both for us and for our descendants. And that savior, who's that? That whom? That savior, whoever you would fill in that line, it's the same person in every line, by the way, might end war and arrange all things. And since he, who's that? Since he, that person, by his appearance, excelled even our anticipations, surpassing all those who were before him. And since the day of, who's that? Whose birth? Since the day of whose birth, it was the beginning of the gospel, the good news for the world. Who's that? Caesar. That was the ancient proclamation of Caesar Augustus, who reigned when Jesus was born. Jesus did not enter neutral space. Jesus entered contested space where people were hashing out who's the savior of the world, who's the one that brings happiness. He was in charge. You know what his titles were? Savior, Lord, forgiver of sins, peace, gospel, divine Son of God. When you would enter a Roman city in the ancient world, the first thing you would be greeted by was a statue, typically of the emperor. Why? Because Rome wanted you to know who rules the world. Statues weren't just like neat works that were commissioned, pieces of art of like, yeah, let's throw the artist a bone. They were intentional pieces to remind people who's actually in charge here. They were massive. Some of them were 4 stories high, and you would come and you could see it from the boat in Ephesus even. You would get off and you would come and be confronted by Artemis, the goddess, and you'd be confronted by Caesar Augustus, and you would walk up and you would be reminded who rules the world. You would be reminded of Caesar's omnipresence, that even though he's way out in Rome, we can see him here in Turkey, or what they called Asia Minor. We can see him here in Palestine, or a town called Sotopolis, or the 10 cities in Israel and beyond in the Transjordan called the Decapolis. That you would be confronted by these statues everywhere you went in the Roman Empire. So if you were to say, I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Lord, it was not a benign statement. Okay, cool. You have your religion, we have ours. That was not a benign statement at all. There's no separation of church and state. The state is religion. And you'd better pledge allegiance to Caesar or else. Let's look at a map from last week. You've seen this. I want to show you that these were the nations that came together at Pentecost when the Spirit broke out, and they go back to their nations and begin to spread the gospel of Jesus, not of Caesar. And you can see, I want to show you this town. I put a black arrow there in the top part of the Galilee. It's called Caesarea Philippi. Here is what they think it would have looked like in the ancient times. Actually, that sort of left side of the temple to Augustus was not there. It was in another part of the city, so that's a misprint. But behind it, there's a grotto. That grotto is a body of water in that rock that they believed went into the underworld called Hades. And they believed every single day that Pan, who had these etches in this big rock, can we say that together? Rock? Rock, it's important, it's going to come back. In this rock with etches for Pan worship, they would put the god Pan in there, and they would have sexual acts right there in the middle of the town. You could come, and men only would engage temple prostitutes right there in the middle of the street. You would come, and they believed that Pan every night would go down in the grotto, the gates of Hades, and would come up every single night into the day and be posted there and wanted to be pleased by what he saw. Next to that is the temple to Zeus. And then over there, what I circled is this. We're standing in this place. We're sitting here talking about this story. We go there every single year. Next October, we're going to go back to Caesarea Philippi. And we're going to talk about this and the implications around that rock. This is the place, by the way, that I just have to say, because it was so beautiful, Capers Bar wept in this place for the kingdom of God. It was incredible to see what happened in this conversation. The Spirit just broke out when we were talking about this story. And what I want you to imagine is that you are a new believer in Jesus at this time. It's 2,000 years ago. You're in Caesarea Philippi. You've been greeted by a statue on your way in. And tucked now in your heart, deep within, are these 18 lines that you have come to believe are truth. That I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, our Lord. Not that. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son. In a place like that, let me ask you this, how loud are you going to say that? Like, how honest are you going to be with your neighbors? I don't know, that's controversial. The state is the religion. The creed is the Christian's deepest pledge of allegiance. Your first allegiance now at this time, 2,000 years ago, you're beginning to grapple with the consequences that it's no longer first and foremost to country or to leader or to party or to your job or to your friends, even to your family, that your first allegiance is to King Jesus and not to Caesar Augustus. Huge, hugely significant. Meanwhile, who looms over your town? This guy. This guy looms over in an omnipresence fashion over everything that you do. And what are his titles? Savior, Lord, Peace, Gospel. And we come to this text in Matthew 16. Bring yourself into Caesarea Philippi, which, by the way, Caesarea Philippi, who do they name that city for? Caesar. And it was named by Herod Philip, who was doing bidding for Caesar. Herod Philip was a son of Herod the Great. The whole town, this is right above the Galilee where Jesus did his ministry. Jesus was here. He brought his disciples here, and they named it after Caesar. This is the crown jewel of the Roman Empire in Palestine. And this is where they're having this conversation, is in that town with Pan worship going on in the corner. And it reads this, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, what's he doing there? It's crazy. He asked his disciples, who most assuredly had never been there in their lives, who do the people say the Son of Man is? And you got to be thinking, shh, quiet. We got a statue around the corner, right? Who do they say the Son of Man is? Well, some say it's John the Baptist or Elijah or Jeremiah, one of the prophets. Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter, always with the chutzpah. Simon Peter comes forward. You are the Messiah. You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. This was not revealed to you by flesh and blood. Let me tell you, your reasonable, amazing cognitive power did not convince you that Jesus is Lord. There's something in the human heart that says he's risen from the dead. I cannot shake that. I believe it. It's been revealed by God. If you would be in here and say, I'm a Jesus person, it's not because you're smart. It's because God is so good to say, let me reveal the mystery of the universe. This is it. He is my son and he's risen from the dead. He's coming again and he rules the entire planet. Serve him, because that's where the story is headed. It's a beautiful thing. Continues on. But by my Father in heaven, which we looked at last week, and I tell you, you are Peter. And on this, what? Well, isn't that interesting that Jesus would use his context to make his point? On this rock, not that rock. You see that big rock? He said, no, that's where Rome says things are headed, the worship of all these things. But let me tell you, when I hear people confess who I am, I'll build my church on that rock. That's the rock I'll build. And I think this is where the Roman Catholic Church misses the point. I don't think he's saying he's going to build it on Peter himself. I think what he's saying is, I'm going to build it on any community that will put me in the center as Christ and Lord. I will build my church there. Not on social justice issues that we leave Jesus. When you build your house on Jesus, I will build something there that will blow your mind. So stay with him. Stay with Jesus and watch what God does. And the gates of Hades, the gates of what? Remember Hades, that little grotto where Pan came up? It's not going to overcome it. Don't live in fear of Caesar. I'm telling you, Caesar's not where the story's headed. Do we have Caesar today? No. Why? Because his story's ended. And the way of Jesus prevails. But he says in the creed, the framers knew this. And they said, for a church to stay centered on who she is, it's this confession that I believe in my heart, I believe in all of who I am, that Jesus Christ, his only son, is our Lord. What does it mean to be Christ? It means that he is the king and the Messiah. Christ is the Greek word for the Hebrew word Mashiach, where we get Messiah. And what does that mean? It means that he is the anointed one from David. He is the king, not Caesar. And he says, not only is he king, he's the only son. Caesar's not the son of God. It was interesting growing up. I got into cults when I was in high school, like not personally, but here. Like I started reading this book called Kingdom of the Cults because I was really fascinated, like why do people believe all these sort of offshoots of stuff? And I started reading a lot about the Jehovah's Witness and I got really involved with like trying to understand why they believe what they do and, you know, so one day the doorbell rings and my mom's like, AJ's got it. So I'm 16 or so, I don't know. And I answer the door and hello, oh, you're here to talk about, come on in, you're right here. So we go inside and we open the scripture and what happens is their translation of John 1:1, it's this little article. And it's funny, it's like flights with radar, like it's this tiniest little thing that sends you in so many different directions of disparity. And so we sat down and they started telling me the story and it was great. And so we opened John 1 and what we read, there's a gap. The article's not there. The article is either A or the. A is indefinite. It means it could be anything. It's a tree. But if it's the tree, well, then it's a specific tree. And that's missing in the Greek text because there's a reason why it's missing because it's assumed something. They assume it's definite if it's missing. And so what they read is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. And what we read is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was the God. Isn't that amazing? One little article, boom! And we couldn't come to terms in that living room and had to agree to disagree. And it's fascinating to me how something so seemingly minuscule is so huge. And I'll say even today, aside from the Jehovah's Witnesses, we're seeing a massive move toward generalizing Jesus. Jesus is not our homeboy. Jesus is not our guru. Jesus is not someone that just mysteriously tapped into Christ's consciousness, and you can too. Jesus is the unique Son of God, who accomplished something that none of us could have. And in the ancient world, the gods are angry. So you better appease them. In the ancient world, Caesar rules, so you better worship. One of the false teachings that comes into Christianity in the early church, about 100 years after the resurrection, was through a guy in Rome named Marcion. Anyone heard of Marcion? Marcion wanted to teach, very influenced by a Greek worldview, that the God of the Old Testament was really angry and mad, and that the God of the New Testament is really kind and good, and those are two different gods altogether. And so Marcion taught that the creator of the world was a very different deity than the redeemer of the world. And we see some of this even trafficking today in the church. This idea that, you know, Old Testament God's bad, New Testament God good, so don't read the Old Testament because it doesn't matter. The creed wants to correct that false teaching by saying, no, we believe in God the Father, Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Oh, and by the way, derivative of that and co-eternal with that is the Son, who is the only Son, the Son of God, our Lord. That the Son of God has always been with the Father, co-eternal, begotten, not made, the Word that becomes flesh, that Jesus is the expression of the Father in flesh. Here's the best way to say it. If you want to know what God the Father is like, get to know Jesus. They're not confused. They're coherent. And here's the problem. Many of your neighbors don't know that. They don't know that. They're still cowering under fear of an angry God. They don't know that God coming in flesh, given the name Jesus, is the expression of God's heart all along. I get excited when we talk about the creed because we get to be a part of this global movement, one that began like this and that has now spread to this. And you're included. This is the story. This is the one that God has been telling. The creed tells the story of God in 18 lines. It corrects and it forms and it roots us into a deeper story that we could never write for ourselves. It invites us into something better. And the creed invites us to say, I believe. It's personal. It's personal that when it comes to the most important person of history, it wants to invite us to consider, what do you believe about Jesus? Where lies your allegiance in life? What is your creed? These are really great questions to consider in your groups this week. At St. Peter's Church, we will forever proclaim as first priority, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. Let's pray. God, thank you for this morning and for the story that you have been writing for so many thousands of years. We're delighted to be a part of it. And we pray that we would live into this story, that we would trust it, that you are Lord over our kids, you are Lord over our families, you are Lord over our jobs, you are Lord over all of life. Every square inch belongs to you. And so we want to resubmit ourselves to your lordship and just say, come have your way. Give us peace where we have been in control and spinning downward. And be our Lord once again. We trust you. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Can we go to the prayer of thanksgiving there? The Lord is here is what we say in that. Let's start that. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Apostle Paul came along and said, for I received from the Lord, meaning I received it, like I'm a part of this longer story that I didn't make up, I received it. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. When he given thanks, he broke it. He said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took this cup and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Let me just say this. Jesus gave us a table to remember him, to remember his centrality. He said, come to this table. Don't come to all the other tertiary things, good or bad. Like, come to me. Make me the center and watch what I do in you. And so that's why we come to this every single week. This table keeps me accountable that we don't run off into all these different tributaries, but stay rooted in his story, rooted in his presence in person. And so, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, come and fill this spiritually and make this for us your body and blood. We ask this in your name. Amen. And so let's stand together if you're willing and able. If you'd like gluten-free today, just ask for it when you come forward. You can also pray. If this isn't your story, but you still want to come forward and receive a blessing, just cross your hands like this. We'd love to bless you. And there's just invitation for whoever you are and wherever you are in your journey. And we say this prayer that Jesus invited us to pray. And so we say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us, and save us from the time of trial, deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And as that story spread to all the world, the three lines that keep the church together go like this. Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. So friends, may you come and receive who God says you already are, the body of Christ. Communion servers, please come forward.
You spoke and worlds were formed. You breathed and life was born. You knew that one day you would come. So far from heaven's throne, clothed in human form, you showed the world the Father's love. And you gave your life away. You gave your life away. You gave your life away for me. Your grace has broken every chain. My sins are gone, my debt's been paid. You gave your life away for me. For me. You lived a sinless life, yet you were crucified. You bought our freedom on the cross. Forsaken for our sin, you died and rose again. Jesus, you are the Lamb of God. And you gave your life away. You gave your life away. You gave your life away for me. Your grace has broken every chain. My sins are gone, my debt's been paid. You gave your life away for me. For me. How glorious, how glorious is your love. If I could sing forever. It's not enough. How glorious is your love? If I could sing forever, it's not enough to say how glorious. And you gave your life away. You gave your life away. You gave your life away for me. Your grace has broken every chain. My sins are gone, my debt's been paid. You gave your life away for me. You gave your life. And you gave your life away. You gave your life away. You gave your life away for me. Your grace has broken every chain. My sins are gone, my debt's been paid. You gave your life away for me. For me. And you gave your life away. You gave your life away. You gave your life away for me. Your grace has broken every chain. My sins are gone, my debt's been paid. You gave your life away for me. For me.
Let's sing this together. He's coming on the clouds.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow
before him.
And our God is the Lamb that was slain. And for the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow
before the Lion and the Lamb.
Every knee will bow
before him. Yeah. Oh. Every knee will bow.
So open up the gates.
So open up the gates. Make way before the King of Kings. Oh, our God who comes to save.
is here to set the captives free.
For who can stop the Lord
Almighty?
And our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow
before him. Our God,
is the Lamb, and the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow
before the Lion and the Lamb.
And every knee will bow
before him. Let's sing this out together. Who can stop? And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, there is no one who can stop the Lord.
And who can stop the Lord
Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Oh, there is no one
who can stop the Lord
Almighty. Yes, who can stop the Lord?
Because our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles.
Yes, every knee will bow.
Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow
before the Lion and the Lamb.
And every knee will bow
before Him. Oh, every knee will bow, and every tongue confess.
Amen and amen. It is so wonderful to worship together, to sing. I love hearing you sing. It's so good to be together. And now as we leave, as we say each and every week at the end of our service, let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen.